All of us here at RTC would like to tell our veterans and all that have served, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Gracias.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I really, really appreciate everything you guys have done for this country.
Hi, I'm Donna McCullough from our RTC Akron office, and I'd like to take a moment and thank all of our veterans, past and present. Thank you for your service, and thank you for our freedom. I'd like to pay special tribute to my father, Don Cooley, who was a United States Marine, and my father-in-law, Harold McCullough, who served in the United States Army and served our country proudly. Thank you.
Lighter, you get at the end of the hole. And then there was chargers on top of the pole, so you've got to cut down with your lighter, and then you've got a little bit of it. I didn't know if I had a battle start for it because I was with the regiment that I was in. My first trip was to Holland. When we landed in Holland,
Mook is a town, village, I should say. We were making a dent. We're in like the middle of it. We got pretty heavy losses out there for a few months. We got into behind an old building in there, and we had a machine gun firing at us. And then we were able to shoot that bazooka over there and cut it out of the guys and drop that machine gun in us. They had a hole dug from a tree. And I fired one over there. It hit the tree, didn't go off. Seems as if my assistant didn't arm it or jump it. So it had still had safety on it. We stopped the machine guns anyway. But it fell right in the machine gun nest and then they disappeared in a hurry. They didn't know what was going to go well. I didn't wasn't going to go well. But nothing done. So you the first few days in combat, you do a lot of dumb things. And you don't know why you done it or why you got away with it. But that's another example of you did.
Lots of time.
time we left college, I got the whole batch of mail at one time. We got back to France, and of course we were retraining, picking up replacements and whatnot. And then on Sunday, December 17th, we went, hey, pack up, we're going out of here in the morning, 5 o'clock. Of course, they don't change nothing. Well, somebody got to checking the radio. That's when the battle of all started. So we went through on a big old open carrier. We called them paddle trucks. They weren't paddle trucks, but they were semis with no roof over it. Some of the guys didn't even have overcoats. A lot of them didn't have armament, didn't have helmets. Because they'd lost them in Holland, we didn't have them got prepared because we were going to get replacements. Well, they do them all then. So we got into Overmont, Belgium, and that's where they unloaded us at. So then we started the Battle of Bulge. And that went on for quite a while. We didn't get as much firefighting very quickly. But when it started, we got a little severe. And we were moved into the lines the next day or two. That, of course, you never know where you're at. You don't know where the enemy's at. He's firing at you, and you're firing over there. You can't see each other. But when them orders come over, he don't. They just send them over to who it may concern. So if it lands on you, like, that was your day to end. We went into the lines there for a year. And by the time we got to that, that would happen. Oh, in early January, they took us into a little village of Pinster for R&R. And it was an old treadmill town. They were going to put us in the old treadmill. And we all got in there, like, here come the citizens of the town. Three soldados come. And it took us through their houses. We slept in their beds. They slept in the basement because the buzz bomb was coming over, so they didn't want them. But we thought that was pretty damn nice. And that had been since the 17th of December, since we'd slept inside. So we kind of liked that. We were there about 7 days. And then, of course, we went back into the lines and then shortly after the first day. About the 3rd of this January, we got into a line in a battle, slight battle. And forget where I'm at. Oh, then we walked back out of there that night. They wanted to rearrange the line. I said, we can't stay down in here and we're stuck out here all by ourselves. We got to get back out of here before the Germans get here. So they walked us out of there. Nice long walk up Christmas Eve. And we got back to La Chapelle. And filling it there in the town. And the road we walked out on, and then the engineers had fixed it all up there. Well, the road toward the trees on both sides for a while. And they had it all wired with explosives. So as soon as we got through there, they blowed the trees down into the road so the tanks couldn't get in through there. That was one of the defensive positions. We got back to La Chapelle, and then we spent Christmas Day there and had cold turkey and little else. Airborne doesn't have all the kitchen supplies that our standard Army military does. We're light infantry. You're airborne if you get on the ground, then you're back down. So we got to dinner eating. I heard the noise in the basement of that house, but how the barns were built all in one piece. We realized there was cattle in the water down the road. So we went down the water, they were feeding water and fed and everything. We started watering and feeding them. Zook and I getting another farm pan. We started milk. We didn't get to drink much of milk, but it disappeared faster than we could get the milk. I'm hungry for fresh milk, I guess. But, then after that, right, of course, we were back in the lines again. We walked quite a maze one morning and wound up in a battle for the little town of Regnat, R-E-G-E-N-A, or E-N-E, I'm not, my French is pretty bad. And there where we were for a few days. One of the things about Holland, I want to tell you about, Zook and I was talking there, and here come an old cow limping on one front leg. She'd got it, she called it, got a rifle blown or something, trapped it in her front leg, and she was dragging it and walking. I told Zook, we might as well butcher her, because she can die anyway. Oh, we shouldn't do that. I said, she's going to die anyway. Well, okay. We killed and slaughtered her. We had steak. It's a little hard to whip a cow when you only got an axe and a sharp knife. And it's a hatchet, I should say, not an axe. We got her hung up in the tree and looked for her. First thing you know, why we had a lot of milk.
Time in Cologne, picked up on a motorcycle and
rode that around for a while and still occupied on the Rhine River. And your turn, Red. I never rode one. But you got a ride one, you never worked on it. I crawled on it, rode out into the street, turned the corner near the street, and I walked right down the middle of the street. No, you do it later and then go. So that ended my motorcycle last night. Well, not long after that, the war was getting fought over, and we went up to Hamburg and out on the north part of the Germany and met the Russians at the Elbe River. And of course, there the Russian tanks. There would be a family on tanks. Father, son, daughter, four or five, whatever took her on the tank. And they all one family. Well, they didn't speak English and we didn't speak Russian. But you could get the message, salute, salute, salute. You know, they had a keg of vodka. Gee, that stuff was. That's more than I was used to. That was way past a little weird. Hey, here again, I survived the war. I got home after my share of the war, but our old High Pointers, the old timers, they went sent them on the home. And us and short time, didn't have enough points, we had to stay. In the 17th Airborne, they moved the two of us together. And we went into Berlin, and we was in there about 4 months on Army of Occupation. Quite a lot of interesting experiences there, too. We can fly the world for a pack of cigarettes. I'll turn this over to Bob and let you tell his part of the story.
Okay.
He's the one who brought all this stuff in here. I brought some things home with me. The 82nd was building the museum down at Fort Bragg, and I sent all my stuff down there. So if you want to see my stuff, you got to go to Fort Bragg.
Southampton, and we had a grass run
And there's a picture of me going, just pulling down the boat to go across. And this is our first field in England. We had to chase the cows off the runway. One plane came in, he was shot up pretty bad, and he couldn't get his wheels down, so he belly landed, and we had a latrine along the side of the runway, and went in buckets in England. And this plane went in between the latrine, and his gun shorted out and started shooting. Bullets went right around the latrine. I said, I'm about ready to get the bucket. This is our different places we went in France. We went out of Southampton 5 days after D-Day. And while we was in the marshalling area, a blood bomb came over. We'd hear it and then go, and then it'd quit. We knew it was going to land for too long. And it lit about a mile from us, and we walked over to where they grew all the trees, all the leaves on the trees for a good city block. And that was filled with nails or just pieces of scrap metal.
Later on, the French gals went out and got the parachutes and made dresses up.
St. Mary Louise. They stopped patting dead still in St. Louis. And then about 2 days later, 8th Air Force started to come over and bombed St. Louis. And by 10 o'clock, you couldn't see the sun for vapor crews. Those X-ray planes come over and they completely annihilated St. Louis. There was nothing left there. This is the pictures of the B-47s that we had on the field. And they weighed 8 tons, unloaded. They took 600 gallons of 100-octane gasoline. They used 100 gallons an hour. And when they had to go farther, they put belly tanks under them. And that's if they just did strafing. And they dropped their belly tanks before they started to attack. But if they carried bombs, they didn't use belly tanks at all. This is the artwork of some of the guys on the plane. Some of the planes take them off. They had 4 50-caliber machine guns on each wing, and they synchronized those guns to hit one point. There's there's the 50-caliber shells, and they fill the wings, each wing up, clear up with shells. Now, this is a tracer, the red. This is armor piercing, and I don't know. They had another black, I don't know what it was. But they dropped bombs close to a railroad. There's what happened to the tracks. Their railroad ties was metal. They didn't have work in it for all night. And they would just fold up. And that's a picture of me. And piggyback. And we was in Germany then, as well as Frankfurt. And on the way in, the motor on the front of the propeller, that's what put the pitch when they take off and cruise and so forth. It went out. So therefore, they had no propeller. We didn't do anything. We were under patent, the food was excellent. boots. German barracks, but and lived Mason, are any of them riders?
Just in the hospital. Okay. I had missed Normandy, and so when I didn't go, my first operation fighter ride was in the hospital. And then, of course, we got in and back to France, and when Final Bowl broke out, like, with no place there to land a glider, so we got hauled up there by trucks. And open top trucks. Nice and warm.
How many troops would be in a glider, in one glider?
American Light Air and 12 troops, and pilot and co-pilot, 14 altogether. And then if he's on an English glider, there was 34 altogether, 30 troops. About the radio engineer. It was as big as a C-47 DC-3.
When the glider was released from the plane, how far would it go before you landed?
Depended how scared you was. You could keep a flight for probably, if you had to, probably for 10 minutes. But you didn't want to be up there that long because your target flying and running around up there. But normally speaking, when you cut those shoes on the ground, they're less than a minute and a half.
The Japanese did this thing. Why do you have an engineer?
Well, I see the British, they had different rules. They did a lot of things differently.
you mentioned earlier about the poles that they had put up. The Germans knew we were coming. Is that correct?
Yeah.
But then you landed in a place where there weren't holes.
Right. There wasn't any holes on top.
Oh, I see. Okay. I got that.
All we had to worry about was a big cow. You didn't want to hit one of 1,400 pound cow.
Sure.
The poles were only poles.
How much information did you get as far as what was happening?
I don't know if you know what the reason was. Oh, we got the Stars and Stripes about every day. Mm-hmm. We had a newspaper about every day. Sometimes we wouldn't get one for a couple of days, maybe two or three at a time. They tried to get it to us every day. Thank you.